Non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, or NAFLD, is emerging as the most common chronic liver condition in the Western world. With the unprecedented rise in the prevalence of this disorder, we have made significant advances in understanding how this condition develops and how it can be managed. However, despite much active research in this area, we continue to wait for effective therapies to become available for use in our patients. This pressing unmet need has been acknowledged by both the scientific and regulatory communities who are working together to make effective therapies a reality. Over the next few minutes, leading experts in the management of NAFLD and NASH will explain why this condition is becoming a health emergency in developed countries around the world today. They will help you recognize patients who are at risk for the condition and how to diagnose them. Finally, we'll talk about options for treating this life-threatening condition, looking at what we have available today, but keeping an eye towards the future. NAFLD is an umbrella term that describes a spectrum of liver injury, ranging from isolated steatosis with a less aggressive course to non-alcoholic steatohepatitis, or NASH, that can progress to advanced fibrosis, cirrhosis, and liver cancer. NASH is the most serious form of NAFLD. Histologically, it is characterized by the presence of steatosis, hepatocellular ballooning, and lobular inflammation with or without hepatic fibrosis. Of these features, ballooning and inflammation are considered to be the two key drivers of NASH activity and fibrosis. A significant proportion of patients with NASH will progress to cirrhosis, end-stage liver disease, and hepatocellular carcinoma. Those NASH patients with fibrosis are at increased risk of disease progression, and fibrosis portends a worse prognosis. Therefore, it is critical to resolve NASH before it has a chance to progress. Earlier this year, an article in Newsweek referred to NASH as the 21st century's looming public health threat. That's because NASH is linked to the growing obesity and diabetes epidemics worldwide and in the U.S. And although as many as 100 million Americans are estimated to have NAFLD, most don't know that they're at risk for NASH or its consequences. As we continue to gain weight, both globally and nationally, the prevalence and impact of NASH is expected to increase. In fact, NASH is projected to be the most common cause of advanced liver disease in just a few short years, even more common than hepatitis C. Over the past 25 years, obesity rates in the U.S. have more than doubled among adults and more than tripled among children. In fact, nearly 38% of American adults are now obese. Our children are following our lead. About 17% of children and teens from 2 to 19 years of age are obese. That's about 12.7 million children and adolescents. The global picture is not much better. Worldwide obesity has more than doubled since 1980, and much of the world's population today live in countries where overweight and obesity kills more people than underweight. Populations in developed countries are expected to get even heavier, and in some countries, 2 out of every 3 people are projected to be obese within 10 years. Not surprisingly, rising rates of diabetes have paralleled the escalating rates of obesity in the United States over the past several decades. As the global epidemic of obesity continues to fuel metabolic conditions, such as diabetes and dyslipidemia, how common is NASH? The prevalence of NAFLD depends on how it is detected. In fact, we don't really know how common NASH is in the world or in the U.S. because our estimates are limited by prospective liver biopsy-based studies. Global estimates of NAFLD in industrialized countries range from 20 to 30% and are typically lower in developing countries. In the United States, the overall prevalence of NAFLD is thought to be around 25%. The overall prevalence of NASH is less well known, but has been estimated to be about 5%, with some estimates as high as 12%. Among the morbidly obese or diabetic patient, prevalence rates for NAFLD are thought to be much higher. Indeed, this number rises significantly in those with type 2 diabetes, 60 to 70%, obesity, 80 to 90%, or metabolic syndrome, about 50%. A number of studies have also found that the prevalence of NAFLD is higher in males than females, and that it generally increases with age. Studies in the U.S. consistently show the prevalence to be higher in Hispanics, followed by Caucasians and African Americans. The growing epidemic of obesity is also driving the rising prevalence of NAFLD in children and adolescents. Pediatric NAFLD has reached epidemic proportions over the past decade and has become one of the most frequent chronic liver diseases in the global child population. Pediatric NASH can be severe and progressive, and reports of adolescents with cirrhosis serve as a stark reminder of the urgent need to recognize and manage this disease.
NAFLD is increasingly recognized as the hepatic component of the metabolic syndrome, and with this in mind, it's important to realize that the most common cause of death in NASH patients remains related to cardiovascular conditions, followed by non-hepatic malignancies, and then liver-related death. Subsequently, when evaluating patients with NAFLD, it's important to realize the overall systemic and cardiometabolic health of the patient and not just focus on the liver. Isolated steatosis, or the presence of fat in greater than 5% of hepatocytes, is a less aggressive condition that generally does not increase a patient's risk for liver-related morbidity and mortality. In about 20 to 25% of cases, patients with fatty liver may have underlying NASH, which can progress in liver disease severity and its subsequent devastating consequences. Why do some patients with fatty liver only have milder forms of disease, while others are susceptible to fatty liver that can progress to advanced liver disease? Who is this population at risk for disease progression? These questions currently remain unanswered but are actively being researched at this time. Although we're still learning about the natural history and pathogenesis of NAFLD, we understand that the majority of patients with fatty liver will experience little or no progression to fibrosis, while about a quarter of patients will develop histologic NASH. Over the course of the following 15 years or so, roughly 10% of these patients will develop cirrhosis, but this is highly variable and depends on comorbid conditions such as diabetes. About 7% of these patients will go on to develop hepatocellular carcinoma over the next decade, while about one-third will progress to decompensated cirrhosis. NASH is now the second leading cause of liver transplantation in the United States and the leading cause of hepatocellular carcinoma. We've also recognized that patients with NASH are at increased risk of cardiac morbidity and mortality. As previously noted, cardiovascular disease is the leading cause of death in patients with NASH, followed by malignancy and liver disease in that order. While we don't fully understand how steatosis progresses to NASH, we know that a complex interplay between visceral fat and insulin resistance is involved. The mechanism of liver injury is believed to involve multiple hits that involve insulin resistance, oxidative stress, apoptosis, and changes in adipocytokine levels. So recognizing the consequences of NASH, can we predict which of our patients are at higher risk of progression to NASH? The risk of progression from NAFLD to NASH and fibrosis has been linked to various metabolic, demographic, and histologic factors. In patients with NAFLD, metabolic syndrome more than triples the risk of developing histologic NASH and severe fibrosis. The risk of developing advanced fibrosis increases with the number of metabolic conditions.
A feature that is notably absent here is liver aminotransferases, which have not been found to have predictive value in NAFLD. On the contrary, because serum ALT can be normal in up to 60% of patients with NASH, increased ALT cannot be used to predict progression to NASH. NAFLD is generally a silent disease. While a minority of patients will have intermittent right upper quadrant discomfort, fullness, or fatigue, most will have no symptoms. So most patients are unaware that they are at risk for NASH and its consequences. This is not that dissimilar from hypertension, where you have to test for it to find it and then treat it. The condition is usually found incidentally on imaging when patient undergoes testing for an unrelated symptom or condition or has liver enzymes checked for unrelated reasons. One of the main reasons NASH is underdiagnosed is that a liver biopsy is required to confirm the diagnosis. But liver biopsy is far from a perfect diagnostic tool. It is invasive, it is costly, it is potentially risky and painful, and may understage liver disease severity. Because of the pitfalls of liver biopsy, non-invasive testing for steatohepatitis and fibrosis are being developed and refined as alternatives for diagnosing NASH and NASH at risk of progression to cirrhosis in patients with NAFLD, and also staging the severity of fibrosis. Both clinical tests that rely on demographic data and blood tests and imaging techniques such as elastography, both ultrasound and MRI based, are being studied alone and in combination. International collaborative efforts combining academia, industry, and regulatory agencies are working diligently to find appropriate non-invasive tests to replace liver biopsy in routine clinical practice. One specific clinical test that is being developed by the French biotech company Genfit has identified 5 key predictive parameters to find patients with pre-cirrhotic NASH who are at risk of progression. These are patients who have NASH, but have had an NAFLD activity score of 4 or more, and a fibrosis stage equal to 2 or 3. This panel includes innovative microRNAs. A new algorithm incorporating these 5 parameters has been shown to identify patients who must be treated with a good level of accuracy. That is, an area under the curve score of 0.82. According to recommendations of regulatory agencies, the phase 3 programs are currently targeting this patient population for treatment. With this algorithm, GenFit is helping the community to address a highly relevant question. Further studies are needed, however, before this test is ready for everyday clinical use. In addition to non-invasive testing on the horizon, it is critical that we increase awareness of fatty liver disease across other medical specialties, as hepatologists cannot find and treat all of the patients who have this condition. That means diabetologists, endocrinologists, cardiologists, and even general practitioners should all be aware of NASH and its untoward consequences if left untreated. These providers should also be aware of future therapies that are currently under evaluation today, because ultimately they will all play a key role in identifying, treating, and referring patients with advanced disease to the hepatologist, so that all of the population with the disease can be managed in a proper and efficient way.
Diet and exercise are the mainstay treatment for most patients and will remain so in the long term. A combination of a hypercaloric diet with a daily reduction of calories of about 500 to 1,000 kilocalories per day and moderate intensity exercise that is achievable by the majority of patients is likely to provide the best likelihood of sustaining weight loss over time. The degree of histological improvement is directly proportional to the amount of weight loss, with at least 7% of weight loss needed for improving histology in patients with NASH. And with weight losses in the range of 9 to 10% or greater being needed for fibrosis improvement. But we all know that losing weight is not easy, and it's also very hard to keep that weight off. What we observe in our daily practice with our patients is that only a very small minority of people can actually sustain the kind of weight loss that is necessary to resolve NASH, unless they undergo bariatric surgery. So there's a real need for pharmacological options to treat NASH. Many drug treatments have been studied for fatty liver disease and for NASH, but none have been approved by the United States Food and Drug Administration or European regulatory agencies for this indication today. However, some drugs have been found to be beneficial for NASH. Of the currently available therapies, the treatments that are supported by the most evidence are vitamin E and pioglitazone, or ACTOS. However, these therapies are not without concern, as both have been linked to untoward side effects with long-term use. So to recap, why are we so worried about NASH? First and foremost, the sheer numbers are staggering. Given the obesity epidemic, we face as many as 100 million Americans and many, many more around the world who are likely to have fatty liver disease. Given the high prevalence of the disease and its estimated rate of progression, significant burden on the healthcare system is anticipated in the near future. In fact, NASH is expected to surpass hepatitis C as the leading reason for liver transplantation in the near future. Furthermore, in addition to the hepatic burden of NAFLD, cardiometabolic risk seen in these patients needs to be addressed. The silent nature of the disease only makes matters worse. Because most patients are asymptomatic, they're unaware that they have NAFLD, and more importantly, that they are at risk for NASH and disease progression. Community awareness of fatty liver disease and NASH for both providers and patients is exceptionally poor, and most patients remain undiagnosed. And finally, beyond weight loss, which we know is an uphill battle for most of our patients, we don't yet have an effective FDA-approved treatment option for NASH.
But fortunately, our story doesn't end there, and the future looks promising for the management of NAFLD NASH patients. As we've alluded to through this video, cirrhosis, which is a stage 4 fibrosis, is the main hard outcome that we want to avoid for our patients. Ballooning and inflammation are believed to be the two key drivers of NASH activity, and NASH is the underlying cause of non-alcoholic, non-viral fibrosis. This means that treating NASH effectively may prevent NASH-induced cirrhosis, and that with the resolution of ballooning and inflammation, NASH will resolve. For this reason, the FDA and the EMA have agreed that this is the recommended endpoint for registration trials for new drug development in NASH. So how do we achieve these goals? Remember that the development of NASH starts with liver insults resulting from insulin resistance and other metabolic factors. However, the transformation from steatosis to NASH is a complex process driven by multiple mechanisms involving a myriad of extrinsic and intrinsic pathways. So it stands to reason that no single therapy is likely to resolve NASH. The corollary is that therapies that affect multiple pathways are highly desirable for this condition. This is different from the situation with HCV, where we are now able to cure 99% of patients. However, our knowledge of NASH therapies is similar to where we were with HCV over a decade ago. And even though we are in the early process of drug development, over 20 different drugs are under various stages of investigation for NASH, and two of these agents are even in phase 3 programs, meaning the latest stage before market approval. Their potential is recognized by regulatory agencies, including the FDA and the EMA, which have allowed these programs to be conducted under an accelerated approval process. One of these two leading drugs is elafibranor, a dual agonist of PPAR alpha and delta that addresses NASH through multiple pathways. As mentioned earlier, affecting multiple pathways is an important aspect of any NASH drug, given the multifaceted profile of the disease. As stated by the AASLD and the FDA, it is crucial, and for those already at high risk of cardiovascular disease, it is certainly mandatory to be able to control LDL, HDL, and triglyceride levels. The same is true for insulin resistance-related parameters, such as HOMA-IR or HbA1c. Last but not least, the silent nature of NASH means that drug therapy must be well tolerated by patients. Indeed, patients who may not feel sick may be tempted to stop therapy if treatment is not well tolerated. This may also be an issue for access, as payers may be less likely to reimburse drugs that patients are unlikely to tolerate.
Diabetes, high cholesterol, obesity, having any of these conditions increases the risk for NASH. Preventing and treating NASH, the underlying cause of fibrosis, is vital to stopping progression to cirrhosis. Recognizing fatty liver disease in your own clinical practice and keeping up with the latest advances and research opportunities in your area will all help to address this critical unmet need.